Listening Library presents Storky, How I Lost My Nickname and Won the Girl, by Deborah Garfinkle. Read for you by Bryan Kennedy.
Sunday, August 29th. Hopes for high school. 1. Gina confesses she's madly in love with me. 2. Dad teaches me to drive and buys me a Land Rover. 3. I'm the first freshman ever voted homecoming king. Realistic hopes for high school. 1. Gina doesn't totally blow me off. 2. Dad lets me sit in the front seat of his car. 3. I don't get thrown into a dumpster. Monday, August 30th. High school sucks rocks. 4 people at 4 separate times called me Storky today. I was hoping to lose that lame nickname. How hard is it to say Michael or Mike? It's all my fault for being such a stork. If I looked up the word Storky in the dictionary, I'd probably see my picture. I'm way too tall for my weight, and way too thin for my height. Not to mention the bird legs and wiry hair. Soon people won't even know my real name. They'll probably still be calling me Storky at our 20-year reunion. I'll be in an old age home, and the nurses will call me Storky. I can just see it on my grave. Here lies Storky. 3 people at 3 separate times found out my last name today and went, "Are you Amanda's little brother?" Like they couldn't believe it, that I'm such a dork when she's the queen of Popularville. 0 people ate lunch with me today. I wish Bryan was here. Nothing like your best friend moving out of San Diego the week before school starts. If Bryan was still around, I'd be in his kitchen right now trolling for junk food. Not sitting in my bedroom typing this stuff on the computer about my crappy day. I only started this journal to have something in common with Gina and to let her know I'm a sensitive guy. But I got kind of addicted to it. Kind of. Like a heroin addict kind of needs drugs. I wonder if Gina's doing her journal right now, too, using that pink diary I gave her last year for her birthday. I can just imagine her hunched over it, sitting cross-legged on her bed, in a little white lace nightie. No, better picture her fully clothed at her desk. Otherwise, Rex might go nuts in my pajama bottoms, and I won't be able to concentrate on my journal, or anything else. Okay, now I'm imagining Gina in gray sweatpants and a big black jacket. Oops. Not leather. Something ugly. Polyester. Good, Rex. Maybe right now Gina's twisting her hair as she writes about her perfect, nicknameless, friend-filled day. And her major crush on me. Yeah, right. Minor crush? Not even. Sunday, September 5th. Dad came 21 minutes late and took me out for Spanish food. He said,
"Mercedes Bonifu gave this a 4-fork rating on the radio last week."
And I'm like, ugh, another foodie restaurant. I didn't say that, just thought it. I'd rather go to a movie or bowling, so you don't have to talk so much. We sat at the table racking our brains for stuff to say. At least I did. He mostly chewed on octopus legs, checked out his Rolex, and watched the front door. Finally, Dad's newest bimbo delight showed up. I call her the Thigh Master, because she's always groping Dad's leg. She makes her living getting rid of ladies' hair, facial, and pubic. That's just weird. Bryan said they put hot wax over ladies' pubes, let it dry, and then pull it off. Ow! Why would anyone want to do that? I'm glad I'm not a girl. The Thigh Master's job sounds like the worst in the world. besides the guy who cleans up the animal crap at the petting zoo, and substitute teachers. Dad managed to work in his story again about playing college football against Boomer Esiason, how he intercepted Boomer's big pass in the last quarter of the game. I can quote him on it by now.
"And when I took that ball and turned it around, Boomer looked like his mother had just died on him. He's probably still not over it yet."
Then he always ends with this deep chuckle. Gotta hand it to the Thigh Master, though. She goes, "Who's Boomer Esiason?" She practically sat on Dad's lap, stroking his chest while she talked nonstop, mostly yakking about some friend who got her ankle tattooed in Tijuana. That got her lifting up her sundress to show off the Minnie Mouse tattoo on her thigh, and her and Dad giggling like morons. That's when I started thinking about home improvement, how great it would be to live with both your parents, no sisters in the house, just working on cars every day after school with your dad while your mom made cookies. I guess if I lifted weights or played a sport or at least wasn't a nerd, Dad wouldn't need his girlfriends for company on Sunday nights. Monday, September 6th. Note to self: memorize map of school so you don't have to stare at it while you're walking, because you could bump into people, like two huge lard heads, and they could try to give you a wedgie. They could in fact succeed. You could still be sore 9.5 hours later. Remember to call said lardheads in 10 years if you need pool service for your humongous swimming pool with the swim-up bar and jacuzzi, because that's probably the kind of career they'll have. Pool men. While you'll be either the voice of the Padres, a Humvee Ferrari dealer, or Playboy's talent scout. Tuesday, September 7th. Mom completely humiliated me at my dentist's office today. She just had to bring her rules of evidence flashcards into his waiting room. And she wore her USD Law t-shirt with the toothy guy chasing an ambulance on it. It wouldn't be too bad if you were 25, but not if you're 40 and all the other moms are in polo shirts or suits reading Good Housekeeping and People. I bet she's the oldest person in her entire law school. Then I had to see the annoying Dr. Berman. As I laid back on the chair, he put his pudgy hand through my hair and goes, "Let's take a look at those teeth, Mikey." I don't like people messing with my hair, except girls, maybe. Plus, he still calls me Mikey, and I haven't been Mikey in 8 years. But what really bugged is that after he pushed me off to his assistant, he must have headed right for Mom. When I came back to the waiting room, he goes, "Bye, Geraldine. Study hard. See you Friday." And Mom goes, "Okay, Howard. 8 o'clock. Then she giggled and thanked him for helping her with her flashcards. Yes, my life has gotten even worse. Mom now has a date with my fat dentist. Wednesday, September 8th. Turns out Gina's going on a date, too. Will my good luck streak never end? I biked to her house after school. She looked gorgeous as usual, and patriotic. She wore this American flag halter top that was so tight, the stripes were all curvy. I stood at her door, listing two-letter Scrabble words in my head, the only way I could keep Rex calm in my Fruit of the Looms. She went on and on about this guy who asked her out at lunch today. Gina automatically went to the A-list table the first week of high school. Since Bryan moved away, I have no one to sit with. It sucks.
"He's 16, she said, as I thought of pa, pay, and pie. "He has his own car."
She did her adorable pout and goes,
"How could he be interested in me?"
I go, "He'll love you. You were so popular in middle school, and everyone thinks you're cute.
Then she smiled and said, "You think?" I wanted to be honest. To say I think you're the most beautiful girl in the universe, and your smile is killing me. Instead, I nodded and asked if she did all the encouraged reading. She's like, "What?" I said, "You know, in the orientation handbook? The Pearl, Wuthering Heights, Waiting for Godot? I read one a week this summer." Couldn't figure out her reaction. She just looked at me with her pretty little mouth open. Awed by Captain Sensitive? Did she think to herself, Michael Pomerantz might seem kind of dorky on the outside, but the inside is what counts, and he's the most deep, insightful, literary, just plain sensitive person I've ever met. Especially for a male. In a heterosexual way, of course. I can't wait to see what other parts of him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.